goes right along with what the Lord had put on my heart to share tonight. You know, let me just say this. In the scriptures in Ephesians, and I don't know, I may preach tonight, but I just wanted to talk. I just wanted to relate to you something the Lord's related to me recently. But, you know, in the scriptures in Ephesians, it talks about the leadership gifts in the church that helps the church be healed and helped and to move forward. And we call them, the term we use, the fivefold ministry gifts. And it's the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher is what it says over there in Ephesians. The apostle and prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. You know, your hand is kind of a type and shadow of that. The apostle is one who is more of a governmental office, kind of able to clinch, you know, bring things together, make it all work. And that's kind of like your thumb. You know, if you didn't have a thumb, you wouldn't be able to really grab things like you need to or hold on to things. And then, of course, this finger, the one we used to point with, that's kind of like the prophet's office. The prophet's always pointing out into the future, you know, and I used to think I was weird. Well, I didn't really think I was weird. I just struggled a lot of times with how I was. And I heard Tim Clement, who operated the prophet's office before he moved to heaven to Jerusalem. He's probably still up there operating it, I guess, but he said, you know, he said, a prophet, a person is called to the prophetic, and I was called to that. I knew in the late 70s I was called to that. He says, they live about half of their life in the future, and I thought, that's what that is.
Yeah.
Amen.
It just seems like my thoughts are always going out there, where we're going. So it's, you know, and you don't go to a person who has prophetic gifts and let them just lead your life or tell you everything to do.
Right.
But that is the main anointing upon a prophetic ministry is to reveal things, not just things in the future, but reveal things as well. The revelation gifts there in 1 Corinthians. And then that middle finger is the evangelist. The evangelist reaches out. Evangelists go out into the world. They're kind of like the lumberjacks in the body of Christ. They go out and cut down a bunch of trees, get a bunch of people saved, then they turn their saw off and leave. And the rest of the body has to come and make furniture out of it. They turn it over to the pastor, right? Praise God. So that middle finger that reaches out beyond your other fingers. And then this ring finger, the one we call the ring finger, you know, I don't know that it's literally true, but they say that the tradition of having a wedding ring on that finger is they believe that vein or that artery in your hand there runs all the way to your heart. So it's about love. It's about a shepherd's heart.
Right.
Shepherds, a person has a shepherd's heart. They love the sheep and give their life to the sheep. That's why Jesus is so wonderful. He's our great shepherd. Amen.
Yeah.
And he gives people in the same way. And then lastly is the teacher. The teacher is, it's a ministry that helps you grasp things.
Yep.
A teacher, an anointed teacher can take the Word of God apart and dissect it and show it to you. So you can grasp what's going on. So those five ministries, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. And in recent times in the church, for the most part, it's been a little different in some of the days that we are walking in now. The teaching gift, the pastor's gift, the evangelist gift were honored and respected, and people, you know, received those gifts. But the apostle and prophet have been kind of like, a lot of people are worried prophetic things because there's a lot of weird stuff in the prophetic realm. Well, of course, there is. That's why the Bible gives us explicit, specific instructions on how to judge those things. And they are to be judged. And I'm not afraid. If God uses me prophetically, I'm not afraid for anybody to judge what I say, because if I'm wrong, I want to know it.
Yeah.
I don't want to mislead people. One of the things that I pull back from in that gifting is, Lord, I don't want to say something to somebody that's, you know, going to lead them down the wrong pathway. And then the apostle, of course, there again, that's more of a governing gift and a kind of a hold it all together. But you think about it, if you went home and you tape your forefinger and your thumb together and you tried to function with your hands without the thumb and the forefinger, you can't get much done. You can grab some things, they're going to slip right out of your hand. And that's kind of the way it's been in the church, because we haven't understood the apostolic, we haven't understood the prophetic, and so forth, we've just been kind of, okay, well, here's what the Word says, and my pastor loves me, and we've got some people saved. But yet the overall picture of how the church, and the word church in the Bible, in Greek is ekklesia, it actually has more of a governmental connotation than it does anything else. A force of God, a government of God, moves forward and makes disciples of the nations. And really, to be honest about it, much of the problems and the stuff that has gone on in our nation has been because in most churches and in most denominations, they don't honor the prophet and they don't honor the apostle. Matter of fact, they'll tell you that those don't even exist anymore sometimes. But they are still viable. The Bible says over there in Ephesians that they'll be in the church, in the body, until we all come into the fullness of the similitude of Christ. And that hasn't happened yet. Amen? Now, this church has a prophetic mantle on it. And what I mean about that is this church, our calling here, is to be a church of miracles and healings, a place where people's lives flourish. But the prophetic is a part of people flourishing. Yeah. Larry Huggins, who's a prophet, prophesied to us in 1998. There were two angels that were, they were like foreman angels, if you want to use that term, that brought angels from heaven, and you know, back and forth, they had authority to bring them and release them and so forth. And one of them was healing and miracles, the other one was prosperity and blessing. And when we went through that tough time that a lot of other people went through, back in 2007 to 2011, we were still doing what God told us to do, and everything. And God was faithful. He kept our head above water, but we had lost ground instead of gained ground.
Amen.
And my wife was praying one day, and the Lord reminded her of that prophecy that came back in 1998. Now, the Bible says, you believe the prophet, you'll prosper.
Yes.
Doesn't say just because you got a prophecy, you'll prosper.
Right.
It says, if you believe the prophet, you'll prosper.
Amen.
Prosper in what? In what the prophet said.
Exactly.
Amen? Jesus, when they refused to receive him as a prophet in his own home church, his statement was, a prophet is not without honor except among his own family's own kin. Because people tend to judge you by the flesh. They don't judge you by the gift that's in you. And the Bible says very explicitly, we are not to judge each other or even know each other after the flesh anymore. You need to learn how to get in the Holy Ghost, look past the veil of the flesh, and see who that person is in God.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Amen.
You might want to do that for yourself, too.
Amen.
That way the devil can't condemn you anymore.
Right.
But we begin to believe that prophecy. We read it. We received it. We believed it. And the very last line said, you can take this and hang it on the wall. That was the only thing we hadn't done. So Karen duplicated it, and we hung it on the wall. Now, that may sound foolish to you.
What is hanging it on the wall going to be?
I don't know. I don't know what it's going to do. But I can tell you this. When God tells you to do something, whether it looks stupid or not, if you do it, you'll get results.
Yes.
And not long after that, you know the story how somebody walked in the building, handed us a $90,000 check that helped us come out of what we were in. And I didn't prime the pump. I didn't put out letters. I didn't even tell people. See, here's my heart. I want you to know my heart as your pastor. When we have a problem or a challenge around here, I say, Lord, what do you want me to do with that? Do you want me to share that with the congregation? And there have been times when he's told me to. There's other times when he says, don't. And with that situation, he said, don't. So I didn't. And you know, the Lord met that need. It was him, because nobody else even knew what was going on, except maybe a handful of folks, you know, that were on the staff or that kind of thing. So anyway, I went kind of a long way around. I didn't mean to spend that much time, just to say that dream stream she was talking about is simply listening to the prophetic voice of God that is speaking in the earth all the time. And it's speaking in you. If you're a born-again believer, if you've received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you have truly, sincerely given your life to Him, I'm not saying you're a perfect person, but you sincerely have given your life to Him, He lives in you.
Absolutely.
And the Holy Spirit in you is connected with heaven. And He speaks to you and leads you and prompts you. And there's different ways He leads you. He can lead you in dreams and visions. He leads us primarily by the inward witness, the voice of our spirit or the voice of our conscience, that inward knowing. Amen?
Yes.
You go to do something and somehow it's just like, I just feel like I shouldn't. I don't need to do that.
Right.
That's the Holy Spirit witnessing you. Sometimes he'll speak. You'll hear his voice inside you. Other times it's more there again. Sometimes he'll have you turn to a certain scripture and you'll read that scripture and it'll be the answer to your situation. There's different ways that he speaks and he ministers, but the prophetic voice of the Lord needs to be in the church on a daily basis. I'm not saying you're going to have some big major heavy Rebbe from God every day of your life. But I am saying that we need to pay attention to that. You see, over in 1 Samuel, when Samuel was born, it says over there that the problem in Israel, because there was corruption in the temple, the priest, Eli, the high priest, he had two sons who were having sex with women in the temple, and they were also stealing the sacrifices for their own selfish gain. God wasn't in it.
Right.
And the glory had left the temple, and when the glory leaves, when God leaves, but his voice leaves.
Yeah.
And so even under the old covenant, it said during that time, there was no open vision, is the way it says it in the old King James. And that open vision just simply means they weren't hearing from God.
Right.
God had instituted a method. Under the Old Testament, people weren't born again. They didn't have God inside them. He was still outside of them because the cross hadn't happened. But God ordained through the priesthood and through different ways and methods and so forth, ways that he would speak and reveal himself to them. He had prophets that he would anoint that would come and prophesy to the nation and so forth and so on as well. And so there was a way by which they could hear not the audible, but they could understand God's plan for right now in the season they were in.
Right. Yeah.
The Bible says there was a certain tribe of the 12 tribes of Israel by the name of Issachar, and it says that they were people who knew what Israel ought to be doing. They were hearing from God. Amen? And part of the problem with Christians is we get saved, and we just go sit down and we think, okay, well, Jesus is coming back someday and I'll be out of here. But God's saying, wait a minute. If I wanted you out of there, the next breath you took after I got you saved, you'd be out of there.
Right.
I've got things for you to do. I've got a calling and a mantle and anointing upon you.
Amen.
And you're to play a part of a great end time harvest.
Yes.
So God does speak in different ways. Now, one of the things the Lord instituted under the old covenant, under the Mosaic covenant, which we're not under today. We have a new covenant with better promises, the Bible says.
Right.
We have the new covenant that Jesus cut for us between he and his Father. He gave himself. The word covenant means to cut. Jesus spilled his life's blood. He paid the price, not just so that we could be in the favor of God, but so that God could literally come into us. And live in us, and we can become the temple of God. We're the temple of God. Say, I'm the temple of God.
I'm the temple of God.
That's what the Bible says under the new covenant. We, have the Holy Spirit in us. And so under the old covenant, though, under the Mosaic covenant, he had what is called the seven redemptive feasts of God. Think of a year as a circle. God in that circle, that year, that cycle, a year is like a cycle, right? Has four seasons. You know, we go back. I mean, how many of you Christmas came quick this year? Right? Here we are back to Christmas again. When you say you're running in circles, you're right. I mean, I'll get what you mean, but it's true. So there was this cycle, and there were seven redemptive feasts. There was four feasts in the spring. We'll go into the details. We don't have time tonight. But that they would keep these feasts. The first was Passover. Passover to them was God came, judged Egypt, delivered us out of slavery, and brought us into our land, and we're to celebrate that. Now, that was all a type and shadow of a New Testament truth where God brought us out of the devil's kingdom. Pharaoh was a type and shadow of the devil. Egypt's a type and shadow of the devil's kingdom. They weren't sons. They weren't blessed people. They were slaves.
Yes.
And as long as you're in the devil's kingdom, you're his slave.
Yes.
And even when you're not in his kingdom, if you listen to him, he'll turn you into his slave.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
And so they celebrated that because they didn't have any revelatory light and understanding about Jesus and the future and how that Jesus would exactly on the days that they celebrated Passover and in the way they celebrated Passover, he would become a prophetic fulfillment of that and become the real Lamb of God that would not just cover the sins for another year, but would wipe away the sins forever.
Amen.
Amen. So in those seven feasts, there was a prophetic message. You see, the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, is the New Covenant concealed. In other words, in those stories, even those true stories, even the things that happened to people, the story of Joseph, we don't have time to go into it, but the story of Joseph is a wonderful type of Jesus coming in, being rejected by his brethren, the Jews, and then going and preparing a place for them. It's just this wonderful thing that when you look at it, as you go down through the steps, you can see that Jesus was an actual prophetic fulfillment of what a real thing that happened to a man named Joseph.
Yes.
So you can read the Old Testament and see the New Testament in it.
Amen.
And it's really neat to do that. It really strengthens your faith.
Yes, it does.
To help you to see how this whole thing was so perfectly put together by God.
Yeah.
And so in these feasts, there's this spiritual truth. Now, under the Old Covenant, because Israel had to live with God from the outside, and they had to submit to, you know, the priesthood and the prophet and so forth and the law and all that. They had to try to keep the law. They couldn't keep the law. Nobody can keep the law perfectly. So God gave them the sacrificial sacrifices so that they could, by faith, commit a sacrifice or keep a sacrifice that would make up the difference for them not being able to keep the law perfectly. So he was giving them grace and mercy and helping them through. And as long as they honored each one of those feasts, and from their heart, they participated in that. They lived in a circle or a cycle all year of blessing and protection.
Amen.
You see, a circle doesn't have a break in it, does it?
No.
A circle is like a hedge.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
And so there was this hedge of protection around them and living out in the truths of those. But now in the New Testament, or under the New Testament, we can look back at those because the New Testament is concealed in the Old Testament. We can look back at the Old Testament and see the New Testament revealed today.
Right.
Now, one of the feasts, it wasn't instituted through Moses, but it became instituted later on in Israel, is a feast, or I say a feast. It's a holiday. It's a celebration. It's a holy day to them. It's called Hanukkah. Anybody ever hear of Hanukkah?
Yes.
Hanukkah is a winter feast. It happens right around this time of year. As a matter of fact, this year on the Jewish calendar, because the Jews go by the lunar calendar that God gave them to live by. Later on, a Roman emperor came up with a solar calendar, which is the one we live by. And that's why our dates and their dates sometimes don't match up. But sometimes they do. And sometimes it's even a prophetic confirmation of some things in the day and hour in which we're living in. This year, Hanukkah begins on December the 24th. Now, Hanukkah was an 8 or 9 day feast where they would go in and they would do certain things in the temple and so forth. And it was all about light. It was all about rededication and illumination. Everybody say rededication.
Rededication.
What's the Lord been talking to us about the last two Sundays? Rededication, right? And illumination.
Illumination.
You see, as long as I was running from my call, I received a call to ministry at 16 years old. I was illuminated by God. He showed me that he wanted me to go that direction. I ran from it until I was 29 years old. And the further I went in my life, the more confusion and darkness I got into.
Yeah.
The more self-pity I lived in, the more I blamed other people for things that were my fault.
Right.
Moving right along since that went over.
Yeah.
A bit. And so instead of being illuminated and coming into the fullness of what God had for me, I was getting further and further into confusion and darkness.
Yeah.
Well, finally, because people are praying for me, I'm sure, and the Lord, you know, he's a good God. He understands when we're young and we're ignorant of things, we don't know things. He came to me when I was 29, and you know the story, how he came and he confronted me in my work truck, and he began to show me that I was at a place now where he wasn't going to be able to protect me because of youthful ignorance. And he didn't even really talk to me about my call at that point. He talked to me about walking and with him and following him.
Right.
And giving my life to him like I knew I should.
Yeah.
And so, long story short, I made that decision that day. And as soon as I made that decision, from that point on, I began to understand things, see things, comprehend things about me, about the Lord, about his kingdom, about the call of my life that I could not see up to that point. Because when there's rededication, there's illumination.
Glory!
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So there was a feast that, let me just read the history here of Hanukkah. Hanukkah was established back in, the rebellion of the Jews against the Greeks was in 167 B.C. That's a long time ago. There was a Greek ruler who was over Jerusalem and over Israel at that time. The Greeks had taken possession. They'd come in and defeated, you know, a lot of the peoples in that area of the world. And this man, his name was Antiochus, I think is how you say it, Epiphanes. He was a man who was a cruel taskmaster. He didn't respect the Jews, he didn't respect the temple, he didn't respect anything about God. As a matter of fact, he went into the temple and he built an altar to Baal. He built an altar to Zeus, he built an altar to these demon gods. And he even went so far as to sacrifice a pig on the altar. Now, to a Jew, a pig is an unclean animal. He desecrated the temple. He did these things on purpose.
Right.
Kind of an in-your-face type thing. You know, now Baal's going to rule over you. And Baal is just another name for the devil. Down through the years you study, the devil's had all different kinds of names and things like that. But its bottom line is it's always him.
Right.
He even went so far, this man, this Epiphanes guy, he went so far as to call himself God. He made coins with his picture on it and verbiage that pointed to him as God. He would send out his soldiers to the villages around Jerusalem and in Israel, and they would bring this image of him, like this idol of him, and the people were told to bow down and to honor him as God. And if you didn't do it, you died.
Yeah.
Right there. And so he began to oppress Israel. This is actually the Antichrist spirit. If this sounded familiar, it's because the Antichrist spirit that's been in the world, actually, for a long, long, long time, is, and we see in Revelations where that Antichrist spirit is going to rise up and the real Antichrist is going to be manifested. There's been many people in history who've operated under the Antichrist spirit.
Sure.
Adolf Hitler operated under that spirit.
Right.
If we were to take the time to go down the characteristics of that spirit, you would see that Adolf Hitler, his thinking and his life was dominated by that.
Mm-hmm.
And so this man who was operating under this Antichrist spirit, you know, the Bible says in Revelation that the Antichrist will at one point, once he's made this covenant with Israel in the last days, halfway through the tribulation, he'll literally go into the temple, which will have been rebuilt by then, and he will set himself up and demand to be worshipped as God. Some of the characteristics of what were going on at that time was, it was against the law to read the word. Kind of sounds like some things that might have been going on in our nation recently. Can't have Bibles at school. No, they couldn't celebrate any of these redemptive feasts I was talking about. Couldn't go to church. Couldn't go and gather together and worship God. Now, I'm not saying that's happening in our nation, but I'm saying that the thinking and the way some people are moving.
Yeah.
Another thing was, of course, this was always big in Baal worship, was child sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Killing the children. We see that happening in abortion in our nation today. So this is the climate, the spiritual and the political climate that was going on during this time period. Well, one day, these soldiers came to a village there near Israel, near Jerusalem, and they demanded that the people come forward, bow their knee, and confess that this man was God. And an old man stepped forward to do that. There was another man there named Judah Maccabees. And he had five sons. And when this old man stepped forward to worship, he pulled out a sword and killed this man, and then killed one of the soldiers. And then he and his five sons fled into the mountains and raised up a guerrilla warfare group, a small guerrilla warfare of people who decided, we're going to run this Antichrist spirit out of our nation. We're not putting up with this.
Amen.
And so there was this war that went on, and they were greatly outnumbered. They were, you know, it was like a joke that they would even rise up against. But long story short is, they won.
That's right.
They kicked the Greeks out of the land. But they had a temple that had been desecrated. It had to be cleansed. It had to be cleaned. And so they went into the temple, and they went through these certain rituals that they were to go through. God had it in the Torah, in the Word, you know, how to dedicate something, make it holy with sacrifices and so forth. They went in and they did all that, and one of the things that needed to be done was the menorah, the candelabra that was there in the temple before the Holy of Holies. That candelabra had went out, that light had gone out, and that light was never to go out. It's symbolic of God's revelation. You read in Zechariah chapter 4, you read in the book of Revelation and other places, you'll see that there's this candelabra that's before the Lord. There's this menorah that's there before the Lord, and it's symbolic of God's illuminating, or God being light. The Bible says that the first thing God said in Genesis in this world is, let there be light.
Yes.
The Bible says God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Now, we're not just talking about the kind of light that's enabling us to see each other in the natural realm right now. We're talking about illumination, wisdom, comprehension, understanding. Amen?
Yeah.
Because if you don't have knowledge, if you don't have the wisdom, if you don't have the revelation, if you don't know who you are spiritually and what you're to be doing, it's going to be real hard to do the will of God.
Right.
Yeah. And the devil can deceive you into actually fighting against God.
Yeah.
He's pretty good at convincing us of things.
Right.
So they went in, they found, they had to use pure olive oil that had to be squeezed and done, just a super virgin olive oil, and the high priest is the only one who could deem it so and put his stamp on it, and that was all they could use in the candelabra, in the menorah. And they needed enough oil, you know, for to be able to go on for forever, but all they found was one vial or bottle of oil that had not been broken or didn't have the seal broken off. So they only had enough oil for one day to cause the light. And the process they were going to have to do to get more oil was going to take a few days. And so they were only going to be able to have light for one day. It was going to go out again, and they were going to have to wait until they could get enough oil to light it again. But what happened is that God supernaturally intervened and allowed that oil to burn for 8 or 9 days. And so thus they begin to establish a day, a memorial every year, a holiday if you please, called Hanukkah. The word Hanukkah, as I said before, in the Hebrew it means rededication and illumination. Rededication. See, the reason you keep your heart right with God, because if your heart is right with God, you're going to see right. You're going to understand right. Remember Jesus used to teach people, he'd say, those that have ears to hear, let them hear.
Yes.
Everybody heard his words, but not everybody got the illumination that came from his words.
Right.
To some people, it was just a preacher spouting off.
Right.
To other people, they were the words of life, and they comprehended and understood what God was revealing to them. Amen?
Amen.
So they begin to establish this festival every year. It was on the day that it was celebrated is in the wintertime, as we said before. And Jesus actually was a part of this this holiday, Hanukkah, what we're calling the day of illumination and rededication. And during, even today, the Jews, when they celebrate this, they'll celebrate it here on the 24th, they have this little game they let the kids play. They have this little thing that looks like a top, and on the four sides of it are a Hebrew letter. And Hebrew letters translate out into, they have roots, and they translate out into sayings. I'm just kind of making this and saying this in a brief way to just kind of get this across. But those, that little top, when you look at the four letters on it, and you look at what it says is, a great miracle happened here. So that feast that they celebrate, or that holiday they celebrate called Hanukkah, is to remember and honor God that he did a great miracle, a great supernatural miracle, not only of returning the temple to them and the cleansing of the temple, but the illumination of God was the miracle.
Yeah.
Jesus came into the world, and it was, he said of himself, I'm the light of the world. The Bible, the Old Testament prophets prophesied of Jesus, and they said that he would come, and he would be, oh, there's a menorah right there. Jesus came and they said of him that he would be a light to the Gentiles. Over in the Gospel of John, it says, those that sat in darkness, not a lack of natural light, those that sat in the darkness of spiritual confusion, not knowing what to do or what the answer was for their life for eternity, saw a great light. In the Gospel of John chapter 1, it says, in him, in Jesus, was life, L-I-F-E, and the life was the light of men. Hallelujah. When Jesus went around handing out life, raising the dead, healing the sick, hungry people, multiplying food, as he worked the works of God, as the Holy Spirit through him shined the light of who God is, that life was the light. See, anywhere God's at, there'll be life.
Yes.
We have to die to ourselves.
Right.
Amen. We have to choose
to
get on the cross, so to speak, or to not try to be God, run our own life. That's the big mistake Adam and Eve made.
Right.
They listened to the devil. He told them, God's deceiving you here. He knows that if you eat of this tree, you'll have the knowledge of good and evil. And you know, in other words, he was telling them, you can run your own life. And they tried to do that, and it didn't work out too good from that point on. How many of you tried to run your own life besides that it didn't work out too good? Amen. You just heard my testimony about that. So here was this feast, this festival, this holiday, whatever you want to call it. It's in the winter time, and it's right around the time, it's usually in December, it's right around the time we celebrate something called Christmas. Anybody ever heard of Christmas?
Amen.
Christ, Mass.
Yes.
Christmas. Christmas is what? It's the celebration of Jesus' birth.
Yes.
Now, there's some research and this is controversial, so I'm not saying I have really a position on this. There's some research that kind of looks like maybe on December 25th, Jesus was conceived instead of born. And that he was born later in the year. And I won't go into all the reasons why some scholars believe that. But either way, whether he was born or he was conceived, light came into the world.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. God had a sanctified vessel he prepared in Mary. She wasn't a perfect person.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
But God had prepared her, and she had a right heart with God. All I have to do is read Luke 1 and see, and 2 and see that she had a right heart.
Right.
I mean, if God showed up and told you you were going to be pregnant with his child, what would you say? Try to put yourself in the scenario. And when the angel explained to her everything he needed to explain to her, here was her response. And this ought to be our response every time God speaks to us, or we read it in his word. Be it unto me according to your word. And as soon as she said that, Gabriel, the angel that was standing there talking to her, he left. Because the conception had taken place. See, every time God speaks to you or he illuminates his scripture to you and you see it, the light of it and the revelation of what he has for you, if you will have a heart to say, be it unto me according to what he says. The conception of the seed of God begins to be conceived in your spirit. And if you'll continue to nurture that seed, it'll grow up in your life and it'll produce a manifestation of Jesus. Mary used faith to produce the manifestation of Jesus in the flesh.
Amen.
See, Jesus needed to come out of the spirit and be put in a body and come out into this natural world to come down to our level, to face all the tests that we've failed and to pass all of them and then become that perfect sinless sacrifice for us.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen? So here's these two. One's a Jewish holiday, one's a Christian holiday. They're real close together, and this year they run concurrent. Interesting. Interesting, isn't it? Now, what does that say? Well, the Lord uses, and as I said before, I want to make this clear. I hope I'm getting this across tonight. These Jewish holidays, it's not something that we have to go do. We don't have to do the Passover. Jesus was our Passover. We are to celebrate him as Passover. We have a holiday called Easter, and I know there's been mixture in that, and the Easter eggs come from a demon god, Ishtar, and all this stuff. But the bottom line is, it's just like birthdays. There's one group of people it's a cult, actually. They say you shouldn't celebrate birthdays. And I had one of the ladies at my house one day at my door, and she was talking to me about all that. And I told her this. I said, I'm not celebrating a day. I'm celebrating a person.
Right.
They just happen to be born on that day.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
People get hung up on the dumbest stuff.
Yes.
It's amazing, huh?
Yeah.
Of course, we've done the same thing in other ways. But the point being this is that these holidays or these things that happen, they point in a prophetic way. In other words, go back to the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement was back in October. I felt prompted. I believe the Holy Spirit probably had me pray this prayer. I said this. I said, Lord, I've heard other people say that on the Day of Atonement every year, they seem to get a revelation from you about something that they haven't understood before. I'm asking you to give me one. I just prayed that prayer. And I've talked about it before, so I'll go into the details. But on the Day of Atonement, the Lord used something natural. See, God uses natural stuff. Jesus taught about farming, about seeds. He taught, he used natural things that were happening as spiritual illustrations to get a truth across. And on that day, on the Day of Atonement, God used, of all things, a baseball game that he, the way it was all came about, that was set up to show me something about atonement that I didn't really see or know or understand. Now, what was he saying to me in that? He was saying to me that right now in this season, that's available to you.
Yes.
And so here a few days ago, he began to stir me to start praying for you, actually, and myself. In Ephesians chapter 1, he began to stir me to pray that prayer Paul was praying for the Ephesus church, that the Father of glory would give unto us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him.
Amen.
All those people in that church were saved. They all loved God. But Paul was praying for them that they come into an understanding and a wisdom and a revelation, an illumination, if you please,
yes,
to where they could walk in the light of God for their life that day.
Lord, yes.
Amen. You don't just automatically know what to do because you get saved. You have to walk with Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And so I began to be prompted to pray in that way. And then the Lord led me into this Hanukkah thing. When I saw that Christmas and Hanukkah were tracking together, did you know most of the major things that have happened in the earth in our day and our time? Something that's been established. Like, for instance, when Israel was founded, there were Jews and Christians walking together to accomplish that. And he began to stir me about this. He began to show me that type and shadow, that Hanukkah thing, that there needed to be a cleansing, a rededication. Because, see, if it's not clean, God can't accept.
Right.
See, if I'm playing some kind of religious game in my heart with God, well, yeah, God, I give you my life, but can't have this part over here.
Right.
Well, my heart's polluted. There's a mixture.
Right.
And where there's mixture, there's confusion.
Right. Yeah.
You can't live out of your head and God's voice at the same time.
No. Right.
Because you're going to have two conflicting voices. And the devil will have you like a dog chasing your tail the rest of your life. And then you'll get mad at God because he doesn't answer your prayers and can't figure out what's going on.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So he began to talk to me about this, about both of these holidays have to do with the light of the world coming into the earth. They have to do with, as I already said several times, rededication and illumination. Now look here with me. Did you find John 10? Here's Jesus at the Feast of Hanukkah. This thing had already been established by his time. Verse 22, John 10. And it was at Jerusalem, the Feast of Dedication, or Hanukkah. And it was winter. See, that's the only feast they have that's in the winter. And it was the Feast of Dedication, which is what we were talking about. And Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. There came the Jews round about him and said to him, how long do you make us doubt? If you be the Christ, or if, in other words, if you be the Messiah, the Son of God, tell us plainly. But see, he was making a big stir. All the works of the Messiah were demonstrating, and the people were all stirred up about it. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But you believe not, because you are not of my sheep, as I said unto you. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me.
Amen.
Yes. Yeah. You know, how many of you know the 23rd Psalm is probably one of the most popular scriptures in the world?
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd. You got to stop right there and make sure he is before you go any further. Because you don't qualify for the rest of it unless he is. Because a shepherd has to be followed. The voice of the shepherd has to be followed by the sheep.
Amen.
But if you're one of his sheep, if you're in his kingdom, and you're acting like a goat, you're not even going to know his voice.
Right.
Yeah.
You always tell goats. When you tell them the word, they go, yeah, I know, but. Because goats butt.
Yeah.
Sheep follow, goats butt.
Yeah. Right.
That was kind of
a joke.
Weird preacher joke there, but it's very true as well. My sheep hear my voice. See, when you become a sheep, you will hear it. You will see it. You will know it. It'll all start making sense all of a sudden.
Yep.
Not that you'll know everything, and everything will make sense, but you'll have that place where you can come into following him and walking into what he has for you. Now look at verse 28. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I don't care how tough the devil tells you he is. When you're in Christ, you're hidden in him.
Amen.
Now, if you go out and get on the devil's turf and start hanging with him, all bets are off.
Right.
Verse 30. I and my Father are one.
Hallelujah.
And the Jews took up stones again to stone him. Now, you've got to remember, less than 200 years before is when this thing I talked about earlier happened, this Epiphanes thing. And this man was calling himself God. And had, you know, done these things. So these Jews who are celebrating this day where that Epiphanes guy was defeated and ran out of the land, everything had been rededicated, and the light and illumination and blessing of God was supposed to be on the land. It wasn't at this point because they were all playing some kind of phony game too, a lot of them. But they're celebrating this anyway, and all of a sudden Jesus says, I'm God.
Right.
You can see why they picked up the rocks.
Yeah.
Amen? Verse 32, Jesus answered them, many good works have I shown you from my Father. For which of these works do you stone me? The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, because that you, being a man, makest thyself God. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, I said, you are gods? That's in the Psalms. If he called them gods unto whom the word of God came, and the scripture cannot be broken, say ye of him whom the Father hath sanctified, he's talking about himself. Notice the sanctification element. He's talking about sanctification here. That word sanctified actually means to be separate from the world, to be dedicated or consecrated.
Right. Amen.
So you see what he's doing here? He's trying to unfold in their understanding what this holiday is all about. In other words, he's the temple of God.
Right.
Yes.
He's the real temple of God. He's been consecrated, dedicated, separated. That's why a great miracle is happening here in his life all the time.
Amen.
Right. You see that?
Yes.
And he is God, praise God. He's God in the flesh.
He is.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse 37, if I do not the works of my Father, believe me not. But if I do, though you believe not me, believe the works that you may know, and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. By the way, the same thing is true of you. John chapter 17, Jesus prayed his great high priestly prayer before he left the earth. And he went to the cross and then left the earth. And the Bible says we are one spirit with him now. We're in him and he's in us. You are as much in him as my hands are together right now. There is no wiggle room. There's no, the devil can't drive a wedge between that.
No, he cannot.
Amen.
That's right.
There's a good book, a little mini book we've got by Kenneth E. Hagin called In Him. You need to get it and read the scriptures.
Amen.
Because God doesn't look at you as who you are in your earthly tent, your flesh, and your failures, and your humanity.
Right.
He looks at you spiritually and he sees you in his Son.
Thank you, Lord.
and he sees his son in you. And if you'll learn to operate from that perspective, it'll be a lot better for you in your life. Amen?
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Verse 39, therefore they sought again to take him, but he escaped out of their hand, and went away again beyond Jordan into the place where John at first baptized, and there he abode. And many resorted unto him and said, John did no miracle, but all things that John spake of this man were true. See, what are they doing? They listened to the prophetic voice of God. John the Baptist is out there with the anointing of Elijah on him, the Bible says, preparing the pathway for Jesus' first coming to the earth. He's baptizing people, getting them to get their hearts right, repenting before God, sanctifying their temple before God, so that when Jesus comes and he's the light of the world, they'll see him and know him for who he is.
Amen.
That's why two people can sit in church and one person can hear what's being preached instead of going, praise God. Oh, man, yeah. Oh, hey, the Lord gave me that scripture last week.
Right.
And the person right next to him is like, what are you so excited about?
Right.
Because there's a lot of Christians that don't fellowship with God.
Right.
Moving right along, since that went over real big. Hallelujah. You know, I'm not trying to beat anybody up tonight, but if the shoe fits, wear it.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
That's why Jesus said, if you have ears to hear.
Right. You want to have ears to hear.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Praise God. So here's these two. The Lord's dealing with me this last couple of weeks about this illumination and this. See, he just at first it just started for me to pray Ephesians 1. Then what I found is that when you obey God in those promptings, then he takes you to the next step.
Yes.
And the next step. And so the next step. And he starts revealing. He starts putting, like I call it a prophetic puzzle.
Yeah.
He starts putting pieces together as you follow him. And all of a sudden the picture begins to go, you go, hey, wait a minute.
Yes.
I see what this is about.
Amen.
I see what this is about. Praise God.
Yeah.
So turn with me over to what is the name of that book? Isaiah. Chapter 6.
Thank you, Jesus.
Isaiah 60.
Got
it. Now, this is why I want to share this tonight.
The light shines.
And here's, it's been amazing how what Karen has said today, what Mike said, especially what he said to
Brian
today. He said in ministering to Brian, he said that by January the 1st, you're going to know and understand some things.
Amen.
Illumination.
Illumination.
Amen. You can take them all. God's no respecter of persons.
Praise God.
And when he said January 1, I thought, there's another confirmation for me. Because what the Lord, I believe, shared with me was that we are in a time right now. See, what's happening in the world right now is everything is shifting to line up with end time.
Yeah.
The enemy's always working against the Word of God to try to shift things his way. And God will come in as the people pray. He'll take control and he'll shift it back in line for his will, plan, and purposes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's why people are so, you know, it's so up in the air and upheaval and all kinds of things right now. Because God has come in, his angels have come in on the prayers of the people, and things are being shifted to be aligned with God. God's not going to let the devil dictate the last days.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
The devil's going to be here, and his people are going to do certain things and all that kind of thing. But God is wanting us to shift into a place of illumination and enlightenment and revelation where we can follow him.
Amen.
Now here in Isaiah chapter 60, look at verse 1. It says, arise and shine. That sounds like light, right? For your light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For, now he says, here's why you need to do this. Here's why you need to step up into this revelatory light that I'm going to give you and show you to walk in. Because, or behold, understand this, he says, darkness shall cover the earth and gross darkness the people. Now that's not, there again, that's not just some natural darkness. If you look this up and study the words, you'll see the words gross darkness, they actually mean darkness that can be felt.
Yes,
it's
yes.
A presence.
Yes.
Have you ever been in the presence of
yes.
evil? Of evil spirits?
Yes.
Or something evil spirits have promoted or come up with?
Yes.
You can sense them. Just like you can sense the presence of God in something, you can sense the presence of evil.
Yes.
And he's saying that in these last days, The darkness is going to increase in people because the further they go away from God, the darker it gets. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians that at the end of the last days, there's going to be a time where, and I had a prophetic dream about this about 20 years ago, that there's going to come a time where people are going to be literally deceived. What are the words? Strong delusion.
Right.
In Thessalonians it says, will come under strong delusion. I had a dream one night, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and those words strong delusion were like ringing in my head. I got up and I went in, I looked them up in the Bible, I looked up the definition of the word in the original language, and it literally means that you can be so confused and in such darkness that the lie you're believing makes your choices for you. You don't even have the ability to choose between right and wrong anymore. Light and darkness. That's where the world's going.
Yeah.
Right.
My personal belief is that by the time they get into the last part of the revelation or of the tribulation, that the whole world's going to be insane.
Yes.
Except those that are following the Lord.
Right.
Because they do insane things.
Yeah.
They know that the judgment's coming from God, but yet they're still shaking their fist at it.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Come on, man.
For behold, darkness shall come in the earth, gross darkness to the people. Now look. But the Lord shall arise upon you, and his glory shall be seen upon you. What did Paul write and say about us, about the end time, the end of the last of the last days church? He said that there's going to be a glorious church, or an enlightened church, or a church that's full of light. A church, the Bible even goes on to say in the prophetic scriptures, that will shine like the stars in the heavens.
Come on,
yes.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. And there again, it's not just some kind of, you know, natural light. Although God could illuminate you. I've seen him do that before in situations.
Yep.
I've heard stories of people way back in the pioneer days of our nation where they would have these old brush arbor meetings out in the woods out there, and people would get out there and just pray and pray, and the Holy Ghost would fall on them, the fire of God would fall on them. They said that they'd get in their wagon and their horses to go home, and they'd be like a big light going out through the woods out there. You can see them. Like a lantern or a light. I was in a meeting one time where Kenneth Hagin was up on the stage, and he was preaching, and I'm looking at his face, and I'm going, his face is shining. Then I thought, it must be the TV lights or whatever, because they were recording it on television and all that. And then he stepped out off the stage and walked into a dark corner, and his face was still shining.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God can do those things if you want.
Amen. Hallelujah.
But what he's talking about here is walking in a revelation from God, something that's revealed from God, not something you figured out in your own little pea-brain, small computer here that has just a fraction of understanding and knowledge and wisdom.
Yeah.
You can tap into what the Bible calls the mind of Christ.
Yeah.
1 Corinthians chapter 2 says, we have the mind of Christ. Now, what does that mean? The Holy Spirit, who knows all things about everything all the time. He monitors everything in the spirit, the soul, the natural, heaven, hell, anywhere, any place. The Holy Spirit is aware of it. And he lives in you.
Yes.
And so he can illuminate your mind with thoughts from God. Jesus lived that way. He said, I don't do anything unless I see my Father do it.
Yeah.
I don't go around saying, well, Jerusalem needs some help. Here's how we're going to do it right here. I got a good program for this. No, he walked with God. He listened to God. He sought the Lord. He spent his time at night fellowshipping with the Father. Wasn't some laborious, religious, dead, traditional, trying to earn God's blessing because I prayed for 3 hours, he better honor for you. The Bible says you'll not be heard for your much speaking.
Right.
Right.
It's actually a reward. If you really develop a fellowship relationship with God, you will get hungry for prayer.
Yes.
You'll want to be with him.
Yes.
Matter of fact, you might not even like it too much when you have to leave and not be with him.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
Praise God. I know Paul Keith Davis, I heard him say this one time. He said he had an experience with the Lord where he was reading the Word, and he saw where Jesus would minister all day and then he'd pray all night, and he thought, man, he must have been a real trooper, you know. Here he is, you know, with this kind of a schedule. And Jesus, he said the Lord spoke and said, no, you don't understand. He said, my prayer life was my reward.
Amen.
He said, I got to spend time with my Father. And he said, my Father rejuvenated me, strengthened me, illuminated me, gave me what I needed to go and do.
Yep, amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So getting back to what I was talking about before, and by the way, these scriptures here, in 1st 1, 2, years and years ago, I was praying about the church because I didn't think I was doing things right as a pastor. I didn't, you know, this doesn't seem like it's what it's supposed to be, because we have all these ideas of what things are supposed to be. And many pastors have been driven nuts by that what it's supposed to be thing.
Right.
Looking at somebody else because you don't have as many bodies in the building as they have and you think you're a failure.
Amen. That's right.
Jesus must have been the biggest failure of all then, because he ended up with nobody in the building.
Amen.
Yeah.
When he accomplished the greatest spiritual thing he ever accomplished while he's on earth, they all ran off and left him.
Yeah.
Except John and his mom and a couple of people down there.
Yeah.
Amen.
Right.
Amen. Always count on your mom.
Amen.
Amen. Right.
Amen.
Praise God. Your spiritual mama, whoever that might be.
Yeah.
But the Lord led me to these scriptures. And I didn't even know these scriptures existed at that point. I didn't know Isaiah 61 and 2. And he spoke to me and he said, the church I've called you to plant, because he'd already shown me the church, the end of the church, from the beginning. The Bible says he'll show you the end from the beginning. That's what prophecy is. He gives you something to point at, to believe for, to stand on, and uses the sword as a weapon when the enemy comes and attacks. But he said, the church I've called you to pastor will be at its fullness and its apex. In other words, it'll be what I showed you it's going to be in a day and a time, a spiritual season, a kairos. Kairos means a spiritual season or a time. A kairos when Isaiah 60, 1 and 2 are happening in the earth. And I thought, Isaiah 60, 1 and 2, what's that? And I turned over and I read this. Now that was a number of years ago. And I have seen darkness greatly increase. I say darkness, I'm talking about demonic deception. The works of evil. I've seen it greatly increase. Why? Because the devil has come, he knows his time is short.
That's right.
And he's doing everything he can to try to deceive people into darkness.
Yes.
And he's done a pretty good job of it.
Yeah.
You've got to hand it to him. But you know why he's done a pretty good job of it? Because we haven't done a very good job of shining the light.
That's right.
Jesus said, the light I put in you, that revelation, that who I am in you, he said, don't go hide that thing under a bushel.
That's right.
Put it up on a hill.
That's right. Let it shine.
Let it shine. Let people see it. We're coming into a time, you mark my words, we're coming into a time where people are going to start coming to you because of the light they see in your life.
Right.
They're going to see the difference in you. They're going to see that you have something in you that they don't have in them.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Now let me get specific. I gotta quit here. Let me get specifically to what I felt like the Lord showed me the last couple of weeks. He said to me that we have now, just like the thing with the Day of Atonement, where he showed me something during that day, during that right there, during that season. He said that, and I believe that he said this to me, or I wouldn't be saying it publicly because I have to give an account for everything I get up here to preach. He said, I am opening a door of illumination and revelation for my people to step through and step into, because in this year, 2017, that's coming, things are going to begin to happen at a much greater pace.
Mm-hmm.
In the kingdom of darkness and in God's kingdom. Things are going to begin to happen. There's a shifting that's taking place, and things are going to begin to hop and pop.
Yes!
Yeah.
Now, at first, it's not going to be this big kaboom, nuclear bomb thing. You know, it's going to start small, start slow, but nevertheless, it's going to go. And we're going to have to go with it.
Yes.
Yeah.
When God moves, you better move with him, or you get left in the desert trying to figure it out on your own.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That's right.
Back when I had that dream years and years ago about that thing about strong delusion, he told me, He said, tell the people to listen to the prophetic voice of God, because God's prophetic voice is always speaking.
Yes.
We just read about it.
Yes.
It speaks in you,
yes,
witnesses to you. As you study the Word, you ask Him to talk to you. He reveals things to you. People preach or prophesy. It's in the earth. He's speaking in the earth. He said, tell the people to listen to that voice and follow it, because if they don't, they will come under strong delusion, even though they know me.
Yeah.
And He told me, He said, the devil's going to fine-tune darkness. He's going to make evil look like good and good look like evil,
mm-hmm,
to the human mind.
Right.
See, that's what He did with Eve. He said, oh, this is going to be really good for you. You can do this, and you can have that, and you can be this, and you can run your own life. You can be a humanist. You can worship yourself.
Right.
I don't think so.
Wow. Making man God. And He told me, during that time when I got that dream, he said, the devil's been telling people the same lie He told Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and they've been buying it.
Right.
You don't need God, you can run your own life.
Right.
But now we're coming to the apex, we're coming to the climax of the ages.
Right.
You and I are living in the last of the last days, at the end,
mm-hmm,
of days. I don't know if Jesus is going to come back while I'm alive or not. He hasn't told me whether He's going to or not. And the Bible says He doesn't even know when He's coming back, only His Father.
Right.
So forget about all these people that are putting stuff on the internet saying, on June the 16th, 2070. They don't know.
Right.
Amen. We need to live our life as though He could come back today,
sure,
but plan and hear from God and move forward as,
yes,
though He's not going to come back in our lifetime.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
Keep yourself rapture ready.
Yeah.
But at the same time, understand, you need to get on with the program of what He's called you to do.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Amen.
And so he led me to these scriptures, and He said there's coming a great division between light and darkness. And you're going to be either deceived and fumbling and stumbling around in darkness, or you're going to have the glory and the light of God, the glorious church. The glorious church is going to come forth in glory, in light, in illumination. It's going to be real obvious, just like it was in Egypt. That's another type of shadow of it. Here that God's people are living in Goshen. They weren't living in the city there where Pharaoh was and where the Egyptians were that worshiped demon God. They're over here. They're the covenant children of God. And every one of these 10 plagues and judgments that fell on Egypt, none of them touched Goshen. That would have got my attention. I don't know about you.
Yeah.
Right.
This is the kind of time we're coming into.
Yes.
Now, God is wanting you and I, He doesn't want us to become some old dry, religious, dead, stiff wineskin. Because He's getting ready to pour the Holy Ghost new wine in a generation and in a people for a time where that we should be able to move and expand. You know, a new wineskin is supple and pliable, and when it was an animal skin, and when they would pour that wine into it, as the wine would expand, as it, you know, it would, what do they call that process?
Ferment.
As that would happen, the wine skin had to be pliable enough to expand with it, otherwise it blew up and wasted the wine and destroyed the wine skin. When people get stiff and set in their ways, bless God, this is the way Grandma taught it, I bought it, and I'm living this way for the rest. You better find out what Jesus taught. Grandma might have walked in some good things, and even certain things that God was doing in her day, and this is the way He wanted her to do it, her church to do it. But that doesn't mean that that's the way it is in your day.
Exactly.
Amen?
Amen.
And so here's what I believe He showed me. And I heard it confirmed when Mike said, he said that if you will open your heart and seek the Lord and ask Him to illuminate you, to ask Him to give you revelatory understanding. It's the same thing Karen was talking about with Solomon. That this, coming into this Christmas week, this Hanukkah week, through that time, and he'd said this specifically to me, that's why it amazed me so much when I heard that. By January 1, you're going to understand and know some things and see some things that you don't understand, know, and see right now. Now, it might not be some big old bombshell, you know, thing. It might just be a subtle, I need to do that.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
You know, you're like a train going down the tracks. You get off track a little bit. God says, boop. He puts you right back on.
Thank you, Lord.
But I'll tell you what, that's, that small adjustment will keep you from in and up out somewhere you don't need to be. Now, this is serious. See, this is what was going on in Jesus' day. He was the light. He was releasing revelation. People that walked with him and saw, you know, had a right heart, had been had repented before God and truly given their heart to God and wanted God's will in their life and were listening to him and following him, they walked in that light. They saw who he was as Messiah. When he came in riding on the donkey, to be received as Messiah, they were the ones shouting Hosanna and throwing their clothes at his feet. All the religious people are mad because they're shouting it and celebrating him as Messiah. Because they couldn't see it.
Right.
They were stumbling in darkness. Jesus warned them. He said, you're going to miss the day of your visitation. He wept over the city. He said, you're missing the day of your visitation. That word visitation in that scripture, I looked it up one day, and it means this, a time or a season when a bishop or a spiritual authority or leader comes to cover you with his mantle and his anointing to bless you and protect you.
Thank you, Lord.
That's what he'd come to Israel to do. But because they were walking in dark instead of light, the devil convinced them that evil was good and good was evil. And they became hypocritical in it and actually became co-partners with the devil in the murder of the Son of God. Jesus prophesied to him and said, this temple's going to be taken down. That looked like me saying to you that Madera's going to blow up tomorrow. That's how ridiculous that sounded to their minds. And he even prophesied and warned, we've got it recorded in the Gospels. He said, when you see this city surrounded by armies, flee to the mountains. Because it's going to happen. And the people, and it's recorded in history in different books, the people that believed him and fled to the mountains, they were able to stay in Israel and move on. There's always been a Jewish presence in Israel in the land. Everybody else got taken into slavery or killed and scattered to the nation for 2,000 years and didn't return until 1948. What happened? Things shifted. Things changed. Things shifted. Everybody knows things are changing.
Right.
In here we know it.
Yes.
We can't figure it out up here sometimes. I'm so excited these days.
Yes.
I'm so excited with anticipation. I don't even know what I'm excited about sometimes.
Amen.
I know.
Right.
But it's spiritual.
Right.
There's just this anticipation in me.
So
true. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Some people think about the last days, they get scared. I'm not scared. The devil's defeated.
That's right. Yeah.
Well, what if they kill you? Instant death, instant glory. What if you become a martyr? Well, that's some more innocent blood the devil's going to have to pay for.
Amen.
That'll open the door for God to do, legally for God to do some things.
Amen.
Now, I'm not going to go out and make myself a martyr or talk myself into being a martyr. I don't want to leave earth till God wants me to leave earth.
Amen.
But what I'm saying to you right now is, I'm just asking you. Well, here's what the Lord asked me. I hate to even say stuff like this because people think, well, like, this is the way you do it. I was talking to him. I said, Lord, do you want me to fast? He said, can you fast TV?
Right.
Guess he knows how I am.
That's good.
I like what Blue Eagle says. He said, I'm building more 40-day fast than you can imagine. But what if he's telling me? Turn the TV off. Spend that time that you'd normally be watching TV with me over the next however many days. And I'm telling you, you're going to start understanding some things.
Yes. Yes.
You're going to start seeing some things.
Yes.
I'm not saying you're even going to understand it all.
Right.
But God's going to begin to bring illumination to you in this season if you'll open your heart to it.
Yes.
Because here's the scripture he gave me 2 years ago out of Ephesians 3, and I'll close with this. He had me on this. I love the Holy Spirit. You know, he's always ahead of the ball game. He'd been drawing me to these scriptures, and I'd read them and pray them and say them, but then I had a couple of people confirm them to me. The Bible says the principle is out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let it be established. And so there was a couple of witnesses that came up to me and said, here's the scripture for you that you need to believe. And it's Ephesians chapter 3. It says, God is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond and above what we can even ask or think.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Whatever you think God's getting ready to do, It's going to be beyond that.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Not long after he started dealing with me about that scripture, I heard Bobby Connor say, the Lord spoke to him. He said, Bobby, I give you permission to exaggerate about what I'm about to do in the earth.
Exaggerate.
Yeah. And he said, Lord, I'm not going to exaggerate. That's not right. He says, you're going to have to give me scripture for that. And he gave him that scripture. It's beyond what you can ask or think. So you just tell him what you just think as far as you can think.
Yeah.
Talk as big as you can talk.
Yes.
He says, it's going to be beyond that.
Come on.
Amen.
So do you see why we need to hear what he's saying?
Yes.
Dear Lord.
We need to understand. What if an angel shows up in your bedroom one day and says, hail, mighty man of valor.
Yes.
Go down there and cut down that Ashtoreth pole. Go out there and destroy that altar to Baal. Fresno's going to get saved, if you will.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes. Amen.
Gideon's over there hiding out. And an angel shows up and says, you're not a coward. You're a mighty man of valor. You're put on this earth to, and in Gideon's name means feller, F-E-L-L-E-R. I'm sure he was a good feller, but not that kind of feller. To cut down, he was to slay men, to slay the enemies, to set the people free. See how God sees you as totally, radically different than the way you see
him.
God told me not too long back, I'm 65 now, I turned 65 on October the 2nd. He told me, he said, you can be an elder or you can be an older. It's up to you.
Yeah.
You can just get old and die. Just go sit down and be old. And start saying, I'm old. Y'all, you know how it is when you get old. People talk themselves into early death sometimes.
That's right.
Or he said, you can be an elder.
Right.
What's an elder? I begin to study elder. I don't always assume I know what it means. There may be a new light in Revelation. I begin to understand and see that as an elder is a person who's come to a place in their life where they can turn around to the generations behind them, and they can give the wisdom, they can give the finances, they can help, they can pray, they can intercede, they can do what they need to do from a position of experience and wisdom that they've learned throughout their life, so that the other generation doesn't have to start at square one and learn it all over again. Turning the hearts of the fathers to the children and the children to the
mothers.
Amen.
Some of you in here are going to be spiritual mothers and fathers.
Yeah.
You may not see yourself that way, but too bad, you're getting ready to have babies.
Yes! I know it.
Spiritual babies.
Amen.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Man, I can just go on and on tonight.
Yeah.
No, I'm going to. Praise God. Let's pray. Hallelujah, Father.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Yes. I just want to release this. I feel like I'm supposed to right now. Have a witness. If you receive this as being from the Lord this season, God prophetically confirmed it. I release in Jesus' name, Father, that light will pour in his sino, the vesheri menita, and thus stay the timo prandis quinto febriante. The glory, masheriante, the glory, the light, Lord. We release that in the name of Jesus. We release that prophetically into the lives of your people, those that are in this room, those that might be watching over the internet, that are receiving this in the name of Jesus. I say that angels will come and visit. They might not see an angel or hear it audibly, but there will be the divine influence of those luminous angels of fire, those seraphims, Lord, and those messaging cherubims. I thank you, Father God. I thank you that the glory of the Lord dreams and visions, if need be, Father. Revelation, answers. There's people in here. You've had questions that have lived in you for years and years and years. You've tried to answer them on your own. You gave it your best shot. I understand that. I've done it myself. You've been frustrated. And in some things, you just kind of thrown in the towel. Just said, well, I don't know. Maybe this is just how I am. This is going to be the way it is the rest of my life. The Lord says, no. He says, I'm bringing the answer to you in this day and hour. I'm revealing. I'm illuminating you. And the answer is not going to be according to your own wisdom and understanding. In your mind, when I give you the answer, it may not even seem as though it connects with that problem. But if you'll listen to me and obey me and do what I show you to do, even if it seems trivial, even if it seems little, or even maybe it may seem beyond something that you could do, like Gideon, when I came to him. If you'll obey me, then you will see, says the Lord, that the question will be answered, and you will have victory, and things will begin to change, and you'll begin to move into a fullness. A fullness, you will begin to be elevated up into a fullness of understanding and insight and revelation, and then I'll be able to expand your territory. I'll be able to expand your authority. I'll be able to expand what I'm doing in your life. And you'll find your prayers, your words, your giving, your doing, you'll find it much more effective than it ever has been before. For this is the day of quickly, things moving quickly. Things shifting quickly. This is a day of breakthrough. This is a day when things will change one way or another. So open your heart to me. Hearken to what I've said to you this night. Hear my words, says the Lord. Listen within you during the day. Have an ear toward me. Know that I could speak at any moment in time and reveal these things to thee. Yes, my heart is to bring you into the fullness of your destiny. And I'm going to do it for those that will receive.
Amen.
Those who will choose. Those who will believe.
In
Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We receive it, Lord. I receive it. I receive it, Lord. I receive it. I receive it. I receive it. Be it unto me according to your word. Be it unto me according to your word. Be it unto me according to your word. Yeah, I'm glad you put that up there. That reminded me of something else that the Lord shared with me about that. On Hanukkah, the Jews have their candelabra, and they have the one tall candle in the middle. They call that a servant candle. Jesus was the one that's higher than all of us, right? His light. They take that the first day of Hanukkah, they go out to the inn, and they light a candle, and they put that one back in the servant place. The next day, they go, and they light another candle. In other words, it's a progressively brighter, 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 brighter light.
Right.
Jesus is going to illuminate you. And as you continue, that's not just this up to January 1st thing. This is the start of it. As you continue to fellowship with him, every day he's going to light another candle. And what he's shown you is going to be a little more clear, a little brighter.
Yes.
You're going to be able to comprehend. So you walk into the fullness of a revelatory comprehension and understanding that the enemy will flee from, because as you walk in the light, as he is in the light, you don't have to deal with the sin element anymore, and you walk in the complete victory. Did you know the light of God drives demons nuts?
Yeah.
Yes.
You know why demons would scream out when Jesus would come to their presence? Because there's a spiritual light emanating from him, and they're in the kingdom of darkness. It's like somebody who's been in a total dark room and you flip bright lights on there. Ah!
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, I've already said enough tonight. Let's stand.